Order.
Members, we have a quorum. Let me call the meeting to order. The last meeting was held on the 22nd of November, and the points raised by members at that meeting are being responded to by the administration, and you will have the reply only later. At the last meeting, members have agreed that we should look at the English version of the bill. We'll continue with the clause-by-clause scrutiny, and we will start with Clause 53, and you may refer to the blue bill, page C1259, or alternatively, page 155 of the marked up copy. And I'm talking about the English version. I introduce the administration team, including officials and also SFC representatives as well as Hong Kong MA representatives, and I shall not introduce you one by one. Ms. Chen, if you have settled down, please walk us through the clauses now.
Thank
you, Chairman. We were at Schedule 5 last time, and we were talking about the new Types 11, 12 regulated activities. Now I will continue to talk about existing regulated activities and how the new system will affect them, and therefore amendments are made. Page 155 of the marked up copy English version, we can see such amendments. The following amendments have to do with existing and new regulated activities and whether there is any overlap between the two groups, and we'd like to clarify the situation. Page 155, advising on futures contracts. This is existing Type 5 regulated activity. The amendment is to differentiate existing regulated activities and the new Type 1 regulated activities so that there will not be any duplication. Therefore, here we say that Type 5 regulated activity will not include Type 11 regulated activity. Okay. Page 156. This is just to clarify the text. 0157. Advising on securities. This is existing Type 4 regulated activity. Page 0158. This is to differentiate this regulated activity and Type 1 regulated activity. 0159. Asset management. This is Type 9. Regulated activity. The scope will be expanded to include OTC derivative products management. Let me spend some time on explaining this. OTC derivative products management in this schedule is further explained. Please turn to 0171 of the version in English. Here you can see an explanation, and it says that this means providing the service of managing a portfolio of OTC derivative products, but some things are excluded. For example, such a service provided by an authorized financial institution or an approved money broker wholly incidentally in carrying out an act that would constitute dealing in OTC derivative products. And also, people holding a Type 11 license and services related to Type 1 activity. And also, if there are services which would constitute securities or futures contracts management, but for the exclusions under some paragraphs, these will be excluded. And there could be further exclusions, and these are also in the marked up copy. Give me a moment. Well, those are the exclusions that I have detailed. Let us go back. 0159 of the marked up copy, asset management. The next one, automated trading services. This is type 7, existing regulated activity. The scope will be expanded to include OTC derivative products or transactions. And then 0160, the next page, further explanations to say that if the relevant activity involves OTC derivative transactions, these will be included. Any questions, members? No questions? Okay, let us continue. However, some excluded activities will not be included. The excluded activities or excluded services are explained on page 169 of the marked up copy in English. You can see the last line on 169, excluded services. And what are these? These are services for trading in OTC derivative products that do not fall within paragraph A, B, or C of the definition of automated trading services. And then B, services for clearing that also constitute type 12 regulated activity and are provided by a person licensed for that regulated activity. Then you do not have to apply for an automated service license. And then part C, these are services provided by an authorized financial institution or an approved money broker. Mr. Kenneth Leung, I'd like to ask a general question. You are making changes, but in fact, what you are doing is to expand the various types of activities, is that right? Or is it that you are expanding some and not others? Chairman, with regard to this new regulation system, we are introducing two new licenses, type 11 and type 12. As for type 7 and type 9 licenses, those scopes will be expanded to include OTC derivatives transactions. But as for other existing activities, there will be no expansion. So here, we need to exclude the possible overlaps. But why do you think you can expand type 7 and type 9 without qualification? What is type 7? Type 7 is automated service. Okay, and type 9 is asset management, is that right? Yes. Why do you think that for asset management, you do not need to have qualification or criteria before you can expand it to include OTC derivative products? Well, actually, there are relevant regulations. Can I ask SFC representatives to explain the situation? Sorry, speaker's not coming through. There are two new types of licenses, type 11 and 12. Those have to do with OTC derivatives transactions. Right now, regulated activities target securities and futures. We have types 1, 2, 4, and 5. It is very clearly written that these four types only target securities and futures. Type 9, asset management, does not differentiate regulation of securities or futures. There is only one type and everything is subsumed under it. We are proposing to expand Type 9 asset management to include OTC derivatives transactions. It doesn't mean that once this is expanded, those who hold a Type 9 license will automatically be able to also involve in OTC derivative transactions. We'll explain in a moment that there will be a process for them to give us notification. If we give the approval, then they will be able to expand the license. Now, you talk about notification, Chairman. It is just a notification. But will you again assess their staff to see whether they have the experience to tackle derivatives products? Mr. Leung, we will have certain requirements. If members agree, let us wait till we come to a later part on transitional arrangements. We will tell you the transitional arrangements for each type and the requirements and also the approval procedure. Okay. Ms. Chen, we can continue, please. Thank you, Chairman. Let us go back to 0160, dealing in futures contracts. This is existing Type 2 regulated activity. Type 1, 11 and Type 12 activities are excluded from this definition. And then 0162, dealing in securities, Type 1 regulated activity. And again, Types 11 and 12 regulated activities are excluded from the definition here. And then we go to 0165. There is a deletion. This is because in Schedule 1 under interpretation, we have already included approved money broker and a definition on it. That definition says that if the meaning is as given in Section 2, Bracket 1 of the Banking Ordinance, since there is already the definition, we don't have to repeat it here. Then 166, leveraged foreign exchange trading. This is Type 3 regulated activity. We have an amendment here. Recognized clearing house activities. Let me explain a little. This is because under this ordinance, and that is the Securities and Futures Ordinance, recognized clearing houses are regulated by other relevant sections. So they will have to register with regard to such activities. Right now, recognized clearing houses do not provide services in leveraged foreign trading, foreign exchange trading. So under the existing definition, there is not such mentioning, because they are not providing the service. But later on, when there is the regulation mechanism on OTC products, recognized clearinghouses will be able to also deal in leveraged foreign exchange trading. So there should be an exclusion because we will have a regulation over them.
Page 0167,
also excludes Type 11 regulation to avoid overlap. 168. Excludes Type 12 to prevent overlap. And from page 169 onwards, in our previous meeting, we had already explained that this is related to Type 11, 12 regulated activities or related activities. We had explained that on the last occasion. We could also discuss 2A. The exclusions in 2A. In paragraph 1, it's Type 11. In the second paragraph, it's the same. And in paragraph 3, it explains paragraph 2 and paragraph 4. It's about Type 12 regulated activity, and we already dealt with that on the last occasion. So we move on to Schedule 8. Schedule 8. Handles the Securities and Futures Appeals Tribunal. So the purpose is under the suggestion of regulatory mechanism and appeals handled by the Monetary Authority and SFC, these will be handled by the Securities and Futures Commission Tribunal. If there's an appeal, it will be handled there, and this is a check and balance to ensure that the SFC and MA decisions are fair and reasonable. So we have listed these decisions, and these can be submitted to the appeals tribunal. So perhaps I should give you some background information. The Appeals Tribunal Chairman, according to the SF Ordinance, will be judges. We have three judges serving as the appeal on the Appeal Tribunal Chairman. The Appeal Tribunal, will it be heard by one judge or three judges? There are two other members, but the chairman is a judge. This includes the MA. It's a historical problem. It doesn't include the Monetary Authority name there. In Section 4A, it's Section 101G or B. Refusal to grant an exemption or imposition. It's a clearing responsibility. If there's a refusal to grant any exemptions or imposition, they can do so in this appeals tribunal. 4B, a suspension or withdrawal of an exemption or amendment. This is reporting clearing exemption. 4C, refusal to designate a person as a central counterparty. This is a designation of a central counterparty. If they have any appeals regarding counterparties, they can do so here. 4D, imposition of any condition. It's the designation of a central counterparty. 4E, amendment or revocation of any condition or imposition. This is also related to designation of a central counterparty, the conditions related to. 4F, revocation of a designation is also related to central counterparty. 4G, refusal to designate a person as a trading platform. This is, if there's a refusal to designate a person as a trading platform, they can appeal here. 4H, imposition of any condition. This is a trading platform designation. 4I, amendment or revocation of condition. It's also related to trading platform. 4J, this is a trading platform designation. 4K, making an entry in the SIP register, as the name implies. This is for a significant party registration. 4L, refusal to remove from the SIP register the name of a person or a specific class entered in respect of a person's name. 4M, taking action to require a registered SIP to do an act. The new edition 40A, the SFC can make variation of any financial resources rule. The new 59A, is in relation to exercise of power to publicly or privately reprimand a registered SIP or to order to pay a pecuniary penalty. Okay, continue. Division 2 lists the specified decision made by monetary authority. This is the disciplinary action decisions. For example, open or non-open reprimand or pecuniary penalty. Part 3, Division 5. This is related to specified decisions in Section 232, Bracket 2. The Section 232, Bracket 2, where when a person makes an appeal and when the decisions will take effect. In fact, if the relevant authorities, for various reasons they think are fit, then notice of a specified decision and effective date will be handled here. Otherwise, it depends on whether the person seeks an appeal or withdraws an appeal, and they have to do so in the specified time in Section 232, Bracket 2. So this just lists the specified decisions referred to in Section 232, Bracket 2. No questions? 8A. So this is 40A and the relevant clauses. Any questions? Then we move on to 1295, Schedule 11. This is the transitional provisions. Before we start, I had previously asked the Secretariat to submit a diagram. They are circulating the diagram now. You can see that this bill has a lot of parts. This part is the transitional provision. Why do we have transitional provisions? It's to minimize the impact on the market. So in the beginning of the new regime, the new regulated activities, Type 1112, and the expanded regulated activities, that is Type 7 and 9, there will be a transitional arrangement. The diagram I circulated just now tries to explain how these arrangements are made in time. The regulated activity, there will be an application period in the beginning of the 3 months of the regulated activity. So if the relevant parties want to make use of the transitional period, then in the 3 months they must make an application to apply for this license. And in the lower part of the diagram, there is a six-month transitional period. So this will take effect when the new regulated activity commences. So in this six-month period, anybody who wishes to carry out these regulated activities or expanded regulated activities, that is the OTC part, they don't need to get a license. So in the 3-month application period, if they have submitted an application and they comply with the conditions, the conditions are spelled out in Schedule 11, then at the end of the transitional period, they will be deemed to be licensed for the relevant new expanded regulated activity with effect from the expiry of the transitional period until the application is approved, refused, or withdrawn. So if they withdraw, Chairman, so does it mean that all the applications can be processed by 6 months? No, it just means that if they don't apply for the license, they can still undertake this regulated activity. They will be deemed to be licensed. So they've made an application. You will have to vet their application. There are some procedures that need to be gone through. Or so even if before you examine the application, they can conduct expanded activities. So what's the situation? This is a new arrangement, but in fact, the market already has people undertaking these activities. So we don't want to create, we don't want to interfere with the market when the new regime takes place. So in the 6 month, they can continue their activities, but they need to submit an application within the 3 month application period, and they need to comply with certain conditions in order to conduct these activities during the transitional period. My question is, so SFC will process the application in 6 months, is it? So let me defer to SFC then. The transitional arrangements, the question is correct. We cannot complete all the vetting in 6 months. So that's why we have this deemed arrangement. They will be deemed to have received the license. So when we receive the license, we'll do some simple checking, see they have experience and so on. If we see that they meet our first initial requirement, they will be deemed to be licensed, and after 6 months, we will continue with our strict procedure. And if we find that they will be granted a license, then we'll give them a license. But after the strict vetting, if we find that they shouldn't have received the license, we will withdraw their license. So if you want to enjoy the transitional period, then you need to make an application in the first 3 months. After the simple checking, you can continue your activities until our strict vetting is concluded.
Right, very clear. Ms. Chan, please carry on. Thank you, Chairman. So we talked about the application period and the transitional period and those concepts. Now let us come to the clauses. Schedule 11, Part 1, Interpretation. That's on page C1295 of the Blue Bill. The first term, amending ordinance, it means this ordinance. Application period. As we said, it will be 3 months beginning on the commencement date for that RA. Commencement date, and that is according to Section 1, Bracket 2 of the amending ordinance, it will be designated by way of a notice. And then confirmation form. It is under section 402, bracket 1 of the existing ordinance, and we are talking about a form under that section. Corporate applicant. With regard to different RA, we have to look at the relevant clauses in this schedule. This will be echoed in a letter part. There are three parts here, A, B, C, specified RA. In fact, we will have an other clause saying that this actually means types 11 and 12 activity, B and C expanded type 9 and C expanded type 7. Deeming date, A, in relation to an applicant who is a corporate applicant, it is the licensed period, and B, the LR applicant, again the licensed period, and number 3, RO applicant, this is about the period which is deemed. Sorry, Chairman, I have a question. Deeming date, there will be an expansion of certain types. Is it that they have to pay a fee on that date, or are there additional fees? SFC, please, Mr. Leung. Sorry, speaker not coming through. Sorry. Thank you, Chairman. Basically, our thinking is that if somebody is deemed a licensee, he will have to comply with the fee charging section in the ordinance. Therefore, once he is deemed to have a license, he will have to pay an annual fee. A new annual fee? Yes. But if you have a stage 2 vetting procedure and in the end he is found not to comply with the requirements and his license is withdrawn, would some fees be reimbursed or refunded? There is not such an arrangement in the law. Because for that person, he has to apply for the license. The application fee is actually the first annual fee. And therefore, the actual annual fee will be charged only 1 year after he is deemed to have the license. Now, if there are so many applications so that we cannot process the applications in a certain period, then he still has to pay the fee, but he can act as any other licensee and undertake the relevant activity, so he still has to pay. Even if he has to pay, he pays a year later, is that right? If, just in case, after in-depth examination, he is found not to be qualified, he still has to pay the fee first, is that right? No, Chairman, what I mean is, supposing the first year, within the first 6 months, I have already processed the application, and we think he is not a suitable person to have a license, then we will reject the application. In that case, there is no question of an annual fee. I was giving you an example just now to say that if indeed there are too many applications, so that we will take more than a year to process certain applications, then after that first year, there will be the requirement of an annual fee, and that person has to pay that annual fee. Chairman, the annual fee will cover the end of the first year till the end of the second year, is that right? Correct. He pays that annual fee, and then within the first month of the second year, you complete the in-depth examination but finds him not qualified. So does it mean that he is paying an extra fee for 11 months? Well, Chairman, this is unique in that we have a transitional period. But then, like other people applying for licenses, he will pay the annual fee. And then he himself can also withdraw from the activity. This may happen a month into the second year, but once the annual fee is paid, there will be no refund. The arrangement is just like other arrangements. Okay. Ms. Chen, please continue. Thank you, Chairman. We were on deeming date. C, RO applicant. The deeming date is the approved date. D, with regard to authorized financial institution, the deeming date will be the registration date. E, this talks about Section 71C of the Banking Ordinance. Actually, this means the officers of registered bodies, and the deeming date is the date of consent. The next term, Executive Director. It explains here that this should be a person who actively participates in the business of the RA or is responsible for directly supervising the business of the RA. These are regarded as executive directors. Existing Type 7 RA. This means that this was immediately before the commencement date of for the new Type 7 activity. Type 7 activity is automated transaction activities. Existing Type 9 RA. This means that it was immediately before the commencement date for the new Type 9 activity, and this is about asset management. Expanded Type 7 RA. This is about OTC derivative transactions and automated transaction activities. Expanded Type 9 RA. This has to do with asset management related to OTC derivatives products. LR applicant. This is about the licensed corporation. And this will be echoed in a letter part. And the relevant sections are listed here. LR application, again, this will be echoed in some other clauses in Schedule 11. New regulated activity. This means a specified regulated activity. As I was saying, in this schedule, it is defined as types 11 and 12 RA, which are new, and also expanded type 7 and type 9 RA. New type 7 activity. After expansion, the new activity included in type 7 RA, and then new type 9 activity again. The new elements in expanded Type 9. No deeming notice. It is defined as a notice issued to the applicant informing him that his application is not deemed to have been approved. Principal. With regard to LR applicant or RO applicant, this means the corporate applicant. Qualification period. We have listed the various qualification period for different RAs. For types 11 and 12 RA or expanded type 7 RA, this means at least 2 years immediately before the commencement date of the RA concerned. And as for expanded Type 9 RA, this we have to look at the relevant sections. With regard to applications under certain sections, this would mean at least 2 years immediately before the commencement date. And for other sections, this means at least 2 years within the 6 years immediately before the commencement date. And when we come to the relevant sections, we will give further explanations. qualifying activity. There are different RAs here, and we mean the commencement date and after the commencement date activities that would constitute RAs. RO applicant, again, this will be echoed in a letter part. Specified regulated activity. This means type 11 and type 12 RA, which are new. Transitional period. When we started with Schedule 11, I show you that diagram, and this means 6 months starting from the commencement of the license period. And then there are a few clauses which, for the sake of clarity, say that if certain terms are mentioned, how they should be interpreted. In this schedule, if a certain section is mentioned, we should deem it to mean a section within the amended ordinance. However, if it talks about a section in the schedule, then this will not be the case. And part bracket 3, in this schedule, a reference to a regulated activity is to be construed as including the new Type 7 activity, the expanded Type 7 RA, the new Type 9 activity, and the expanded Type 9 RA. Bracket 4, for the sake of clarity, some other clauses. In relation to a corporate applicant, if he is related to a certain RA, then it should be deemed as a business in the regulated activity. And then, as for LR applicants, if it is related to a certain RA, then it should be construed as performing for or on behalf of or by arrangement with the principal. Roman 3, with regard to executive officer of an authorized financial institution, and if this is related to an RA, then it should be construed as being responsible for directly supervising the conduct of the business that constitutes the regulated activity. Roman 4, in relation to a licensed representative and a responsible officer and individual deemed under this schedule to be licensed, if there is relation with any RA, this should be construed as performing for or on behalf of or by arrangement with a person or an authorized financial institution. Bracket B, a reference to carrying on a qualifying activity is to be construed a business in the qualifying activity. And also, if this is done on behalf of or by arrangement with another person, and also this could be in relation to an authorized financial institution as being responsible for directly supervising the conduct of the business that constitutes the qualifying activity. All these are there for the sake of clarity. Okay, good. Any questions? If not, we can continue with part 2. Thank you, Chairman. These are transitional arrangements, and you may see that they are quite similar. But part 1 is really about interpretation. And then part 2 is about transitional arrangements for type 11 regulated activity and type 12 regulated activity.
Part 3 is for type 9 activity, and part 4 is for type 7 transition arrangements. So each part will have similar wordings regarding license authority, responsible person, and their transitional arrangements. They will appear in the different parts, and they will look like repeating arrangements. So part two, I said this is for type 11 and type 12 regulated activity transitional arrangements. So clause two says that a person who during that transitional period does an act referred to in section that is type 11, 12 activities, if they do an act referred to in section 11(114)(1) in relation to a specified regulated activity, does not contravene that section. This is existing legislation, and this existing legislation regulates the regulated activity. 114(1) says they cannot conduct regulated activity, and 114(2) unless this person is a licensed authority, is a licensed financial institute, etc., etc. So we had explained the 6-month transition period, and even if they are conducting a regulated activity, they are not in breach of 114. That's it. Clause 2, a person who during the transitional period does an act referred to in section 114(3) does not contravene that section, and 114(3) is existing securities and future legislation. It says that conducting regulated activity, 114(4), the licensed representative or registered financial institute, these people, if they conduct the regulated activity, they do not contravene the law, because that is referring to the 6-month transitional period. Division 2 deals with corporations and individuals. 3(1) says a person who applies in accordance with section 116(1) to carry on a specified regulated activity is deemed to be licensed if they fulfill the conditions. They will be deemed to be licensed. 116(1) is existing legislation. This existing legislation relates to applying for a regulated activity license. 2 says a person who applies in accordance with section 127(1) for variation of the regulated activity specified in the person's license by adding a specified regular activity, they're deemed to be licensed if the conditions in subsection 3 are satisfied. 127(1) is about application for variation in the regulated activity. 3 are the conditions 1 and 2 refer to. 3A, the corporate applicant is a person referred to in section 116(2)(a). 116(2)(a) is existing legislation, and the people they're referring to are companies or body corporates. B says that the application is made within the application period. I explained that. The application period is the commencement date of the regulated activity, the 3 months of the commencement of the regulated activity. C is an application for the purposes of section 130(1), with the exception that the corporate applicant is a licensed corporation and And the premises proposed to be used for keeping records or documents for the purposes of section 130(1). Now let me explain. 130(1) is existing legislation. This legislation says the SFC can approve license corporations to use premises for keeping records or documents. So these are existing conditions. D, not less than two individuals, at least one of whom is an executive director of the corporate application of the an executive director of the corporate applicant, and including at least one executive director of the corporate applicant, have not been issued a no deeming notice. E, every executive of the corporate applicant has applied under section 126 to be approved as a responsible officer, and they have not been issued a no deeming notice. Bracket 4 has to be complied with, and the corporate applicant has not been issued a no deeming notice before the deeming date. Any questions? We're on C1315, and now we move on to bracket 4. The corporate applicant must submit, together with the application, a confirmation form. They need to confirm the application relates to Type 11 regulated activity, that the corporate applicant has been carrying on in Hong Kong a qualifying activity for the qualification period. In B, it refers to Type 12 regulated activity. The qualification period is defined in the interpretation, and this means at least 2 years before the commencement of Type 11, Type 12 regulated activity. C is not less than two individuals, at least one of whom is an executive director of the corporate applicant, and have applied under section 126 to be approved as responsible officers and satisfy conditions 528. D, every executive director of the corporate applicant is an individual who has applied to be approved as a responsible officer and satisfies conditions 5. E says that under section 130, they have made an application and the premises satisfy the requirements. Just now I said 130(1) is the SFC approving the premises to store records and documents. 130(2), that the premises have to be appropriate for the suggested use. The corporate applicant is in compliance or has arrangements to ensure compliance. G, the applicant is in compliance or has arrangements to ensure compliance. Five, the deeming under subsections 1 and 2, they take effect on the date immediately after the end of the transitional period and in accordance with section 6 of the schedule. I mentioned transitional period is 6 months after the commencement date of the regulated activity. So they will be deemed to have received the license. If you have no questions, we'll continue. Clause 4. Deemed licensing of representatives. This is the representative. So an individual who applies in accordance with Section 120 and if they comply with subsection 3, they can be licensed as a licensed representative to carry on for the principal the specified regulated activity. This is the existing legislation in the Securities Futures Ordinance to apply for license as a representative. 120(1) is also existing legislation. This allows the corporate to act to have application to accredited to the principal. And in (2), an individual who applies in accordance with Section 127(1) for variation and who applies in accordance with Section 122(1) if they comply with subsection 3, they can be licensed as a licensed representative under Section 120 to carry on for the principal the regulated activity. 127(1) is existing legislation. It relates to a variation of the regulated activity. In (3), it spells out the conditions. A, the application is made within the application period, that is, the commencement date of the 3 months after the commencement of the regulated activity. B, the application relates to a corporate applicant who has made an application. C, Section 3(3) of the schedule, the principal's application, the principal being the corporate applicant. D, when the application is made, the licensed representative is carrying on or on behalf of the principal the regulated activity. And there has been no issuing of no deeming notice. 4, deeming, when will deeming expire? It will take effect on the date immediately after the end of the transitional period. The transitional period being after the end of the 6 months. And according to Section 8 of the schedule. (5), for the purposes of subsections 1 and 2, the corporation license under Section 116 is to be read as a reference to the principal. For the purposes of subsections 1 and 2, the reference in section to a corporation license under section 116 is to be read as a reference to the principal. Okay, next. 5, deemed approval of responsible officers. An individual who has made a licensed representative application and who also applies in accordance with Section 126(1). If they comply with Subsection 2, they can be deemed as responsible officers.
And then conditions are in (2). These are in the existing legislation, and this is about the approval of responsible officers. The conditions are 2A, that it should be applied for within the application period, and that is 3 months, within 3 months of the commencement of the RA. B, Schedule 4, you have to comply with the conditions there. And then Schedule 3, with regard to the corporate license, the conditions have to be complied with. And then D, subsection 3 is complied with. And E, the RO applicant has not been issued a no deeming notice before the deeming date. Bracket 3. It requires the applicant to submit a confirmation form. The confirmation form is already regulated in the existing law. In that confirmation form, it must confirm A and B, and that is relating to Type 11 and Type 12 RA. The RO applicant has been carrying on in Hong Kong a qualifying activity for the qualification period. And also under interpretation, we have already defined what is the qualification period, and we have defined it to mean at least 2 years. Bracket 4. The deeming under subsection 1. Now, when will that end? And that is the second day after the end of the transitional period, and also in accordance with Section 10 of this schedule. Bracket 5. The reference in Section 126, bracket 1, if a licensed representative is mentioned, it should be read as a reference to an LR applicant, and also the licensed corporation is to be read as a reference to the principal. As I said, 1261 is an existing section, which is on approval of responsible officers. Okay, if there are no questions, we can carry on. Number 6, when deemed status ends. This has to do with corporations. Deemed status. This will end in the following conditions. A, when the application is withdrawn. B, the license is granted. C, the license application is refused. Bracket 2. Under Section 3.2 of the schedule. Now, this is about adding new Type 1 or Type 11, Type 12 license, and that is by converting existing licenses. This will be the deemed status, and when will it end? It is when the application is withdrawn or the license is varied by adding the new specified RAs, or the application is refused. And in these circumstances, whichever happens first will be deemed to have the effect of ending the status. No questions, is that right? Number 7, please. Consequences of deemed status. Corporations. This section applies if a person is deemed to be licensed under Section 3.1 or 2 of this schedule. Bracket 2. During the period the person is deemed to be licensed, the premises are approved. And we are talking about the disposal or keeping of documents, as I have explained. Then this will be regarded as a deemed status. Bracket 3. With regard to the period, for the purposes of Section 13A, bracket 2, this should be the date of the grant of the license. 138, bracket 2, is in the existing ordinance. This is about the date of paying the annual fee. In the existing section, it says that the licensed corporate or corporation should pay the annual fee on the same day of the same month as the time for the grant of the license, unless it is otherwise specified by the SFC. And the date of the grant of the license should be construed to mean the date of the license approval. B, section 138 bracket 4. It is in the existing legislation, and it says that the licensed person, after the license is granted, should pay the annual fee within a month of the renewal of the license, or to submit the annual report within 1 month after the granting of the license. And for the sake of this part, we would regard this as the deemed status date. Number 8, when deemed status ends, this is for representatives. Under section 4.1 of this schedule, an individual deemed to be licensed for a specified RA, but if the following happens, the deemed status of these people will end. A, the application is withdrawn. B, the license is granted. C, the application is refused. Whether it is for a person or for the principal, this is refused. Or the application to vary the principal's license has been refused. And D, if the individual ceases to act for or on behalf of the principal, then again there will be the end of the deemed status. Bracket 2. This is similar, but this is under section 4 bracket 2 of this schedule. And that is if this is done by varying the license, and that is to add type 11 and 12 by varying the license, and if the following happens, again the deemed status will end. This is actually very similar to previous constructions, the application being withdrawn, or the variation of the license by adding in types 11 and 12, or the application is refused, or the person does not act on behalf of the principal anymore, then the deemed status will end. Members, no questions? Then we can carry on. Number 9. Thank you, Chairman. Consequences of deemed status. Representatives. Under 4 bracket 1 of this schedule, if someone is deemed to be licensed, and in respect of the specified RA for which the individual is so deemed, then this section will apply. During the period the individual is deemed to be licensed and after the granting of the license, the deeming date is to be regarded for the purposes of section 1382 and 1384. This should be regarded as the date of the grant of the license. Actually, we explained already 1382 is in the existing law, and that is about the date for the paying of the annual fee. And 1384 is again in the existing law, and it has to do with the submission of the annual report to the SFC, the date for doing so.
moment.
Right, no questions. Number 10. When deemed status ends, this is in relation to responsible officers. Whatever happens in the following series of events, whichever happens first, then the deemed status would end for responsible officers. And these events are A, that the application is withdrawn, 2, the granting of the license is refused, and 3, the application to vary the RA is refused. D, the application as a responsible officer is withdrawn, and E, it is approved, the responsible officer is approved, and F, the responsible officer application is refused, and G, that he no longer act on behalf of the principal, and H, the principal's application is withdrawn, I, a refusal to grant the principal a license, and J, a refusal to vary the RA specified in the principal's license. Okay, no questions. 11. Issue of no deeming notices by SFC. If the SFC is not satisfied that the corporate applicant is acting according to 1161 or 1271, or it is not satisfied that the conditions in Section 3 of the schedule have been met, for example, 3(3), one of the conditions being that within the application period, in other words, application has to be made in the first 3 months. If this is not done, then the SFC may issue a notice to an LR applicant informing him or her that he is not to be deemed to be licensed. Bracket 2 and bracket 3 are similar. Bracket 2 is about an LR applicant. If the application is not done according to conditions in Section 4, then again the no deeming notice can be issued. And bracket 3, this is about application as responsible officers. If the commission is not satisfied that the application is made in accordance with the relevant section, then the no deeming notice can also be issued. But he can still operate for 6 months. Yes, correct. Okay, continue, please. Part 3.
Part 3 is transitional arrangements for new Type 9 activity. Type 9 activity, I'd explained just now, that is asset management services. The new Type 9 activity would include OTC management activities. We have also transitional arrangements for these activities. 12. A person who, in relation to new Type 9 activity, if they conduct an act referred to in Section 114(1), they do not contravene that section. If they are not a person mentioned in 114(2), they do not contravene. 114(2) describes, unless the person is a registered institute and so on. But put simply, so even if they are not registered, they do not breach the ordinance. So a person does an act referred to in Section 1143, does not contravene that section, 104 bracket 3 is existing legislation regarding activities in the regulated activity, even if they are not a they will not contravene 104 bracket 3. Any questions? Let's continue. Division 2 refers to Type 9 activity. 13, deemed licensing of corporations. This applies to a person that is not an authorized financial institution. This will appear in the schedules, and it is also applicable to a person that is not a corporation licensed to carry on existing Type 9 regulated activity. A person who applies in accordance with Section 116 bracket 1 to carry on expanded Type 9 RA is deemed to be licensed under that section if the conditions in subsection 4 are satisfied. 116 bracket 1 is existing legislation. It's an legislation regarding to application for RA. Subsection 3, a person who applies in accordance with section 127 bracket 1 for variation of the regulated activity specified in the person's license by adding the expanded type 9, they will be deemed to be licensed if the conditions in subsection 4 are satisfied. 127 bracket 1 is existing legislation regarding the application for variation. Subsection 4 lists the conditions. A. The corporate applicant is a person referred to in section 116 bracket 2A. That's existing legislation. 116 2A. Refers to a company or body corporate. The B, the application is made within the application period, that is, the first 3 months of the application period. C, an application for the purposes of section 130 bracket 1 is lodged. This is existing legislation. It refers to the premises for storing documents. If they made an application, this is one of the conditions. And we now have exemptions. If the corporate applicant is a licensed corporation and the premises proposed to be used for keeping records are the subject of an existing approval. D, not less than two individuals, at least one of them is an executive director of the corporate applicant and have not been issued a no deeming notice. E, every executive director has applied under section 126 to be approved and have not been issued a no deeming notice. F, subsection 5 is complied with, and G, the corporate applicant has not been issued a no deeming notice. Subsection 5, the corporate applicant must submit a confirmation form. This is an existing legislation as well. They need to confirm A, the corporate applicant has been carrying on a qualifying activity for the qualification period. The qualification period is at least 2 years before the new regulated activity commences. And B, not less than two individuals, at least one of whom is an executive director, of the corporate applicant and have thus in the satisfied conditions in sections 15.2a, such as making an application during the application period. C, every executive director of the corporate applicant is an individual and they are a responsible officer and satisfy conditions 15.2a. D, the corporate applicant has lodged an application under and the premises concerned satisfy the requirements of section 1302a. E, the corporate applicant is in compliance or has arrangements in place. F, the corporate applicant is in compliance subsection 6. The deeming under subsections 2 and 3 will take effect on the date immediately after the end of the transitional period for the new Type 9 activity. And ends in accordance with section 16 of the schedule. Any questions? 14. Deemed licensing of representatives. This section applies to an individual who is not licensed to carry on existing Type 9RA. An individual who applies in accordance with section 120(1) to be licensed to carry on expanded Type 9RA for a corporation, but not as a responsible officer, and who applies in accordance to be accredited to the principal if the conditions in subsection 4 are satisfied. To be licensed as a licensed representative under section 120(1). Section 122, to be accredited to the principal. 3, an individual who applies in accordance with section 127(1) for variation of the regulated activity specified in the individual's license by adding expanded type 9RA if conditions in subsection 4 are satisfied. 127 is an existing legislation. It relates to variation in application. Subsection 4, the conditions are the application is made within the application period, that is in the first 3 months, and the application it relates to a corporate applicant who has made an application. The conditions in the application period are in compliance, and the licensed representative applicant is carrying on for or on behalf of the principal the relevant qualifying activity, and the licensed representative applicant has not been issued a no deeming notice. The deeming under subsections 2 and 3 take effect on the date immediately after the end of the transitional period and ends in accordance with section 18 of the schedule. Subsection 6, for the purposes of subsections 2 and 3, the reference in section 120(1) to a corporation license under section 116 to be read as a reference to the principal. 120(1) is existing legislation. It says the SFC can grant a license and in bracket 7. It's similar. It refers to 122 bracket 1A. That's also is existing legislation. It says the SFC can, according to 116, it can name a principal as a licensed representative. 15. Deemed approval of responsible officers. An individual who has made an LR application and who also applies in accordance with section 126 bracket 1 to be approved as a responsible officer is deemed to be approved in relation to expanded type 9 RA if conditions are satisfied. Subsection 2 says that the application under section 126 in relation to the expanded type 9 RA is made within the application period. The conditions in sections 14 and of the schedule it's in relation to the LR application for the expanded type 9, for example, an application made during the application period. C, the conditions in section 13.4 of the schedule are satisfied, and subsection 3 has to be complied with, and a no deeming notice has not been issued. Subsection 3, the confirmation refers to the RO applicant must submit, together with the application, a confirmation form confirming that the RO applicant has been carrying on in Hong Kong a qualifying activity for the qualification period. We have defined qualification period to be at least 2 years before the new RA commences. Subsection 4, a deeming under subsection 1 will take effect on the date immediately after the end of the transitional period for the new Type 9A activity and ends in accordance with section 20 of the schedule. Subsection 5, for the purposes of subsection 1, the reference on section 126 bracket 1 to be a licensed representative is to be read as a reference to an LR applicant, and the licensed corporation is to be read as a reference to the principal. Section 126 is existing legislation. It relates to permission of permissible persons. They could be a responsible officer of the relevant institute. Section 16. When deemed status ends for corporations. Subsection 1. A person deemed to be licensed under section 13.2 ceases to be deemed on depending on the following events A, B, and C. The applicant's application is withdrawn, the license is granted, or the license is refused. Subsection 2. A person deemed to be licensed under section 13.3 ceases to be deemed on the following events. The corporate applicant's application is withdrawn, the regulated activity in the license is varied, or there is a refusal to vary the regulated activity.
Mr. Kenneth Leung. You say that the event that happens first would mean the end of the status. I like to ask about minor drafting issues. If you look at 16.1, one of the following events that happens, whichever happens first, A, B, and C. Between B and C, should there be or after the semicolon? What is your drafting style? Because sometimes you have the word and. Let me No, sorry, I'm referring to 17. In 17, it says one of the following events. One of the, so it can be either A, B, or C. Now, I like to contrast it with another section. Can I go to 17? Okay, fine. No, still 16. I'm reading the English. 16, 1, A, B, C. When one of the following events happens, between B and C, do you need the word or? What about your drafting instructions? Should there be the word or? Ms. Choi? We don't need the word. If we have the word following, we don't need the word or. But then if we don't say one of the following events, then maybe we need the word or. Ah, that's fine then. We can carry on. 17. 17. Consequence of deemed status. Corporations. According to Section 13.2 or 3, if a person is deemed to be licensed in respect of expanded type 9RA, this section will apply. During the period the person is deemed to be licensed, if the premises in respect of which an application is lodged under Section 1301 are deemed to be approved, the person is deemed to have complied with Section 1303 in relation of the premises. 1301 is an existing section that it says the SFC can approve the corporation using certain premises as a depository of documents. 1303 is about specified circumstances where approval of premises is given. And then C, 1311, the requirement there does not apply. Bracket 3. If the person is deemed to be licensed under Section 13.2 of this schedule, during the period the person is so deemed, for the purposes of Section 1382 and 1384, the date should be regarded as the date of the grant of the license. 1382 is an existing section. It says that after the granting of the license, within a month of the same day and same month, every year thereafter, the annual fee should be paid. And 138 bracket 4 is a similar construction, and that is after the grant of the license. Within a month of the same day, same month, of the years thereafter, there should be the submission of the annual report to the SFC. This can also be done on a day specified by the SFC. Bracket 4. During the period the person is deemed to be licensed under Section 13, bracket 2 or 3 of this schedule, the person is also deemed to be subject to the condition that the person must not carry on securities or futures contracts management. No questions? Okay. Number 18. When deemed status ends, this is about representatives. The date of the ending of deemed status. If the principal's application, in other words, if the corporate applicant's application is withdrawn, or if the individual's application is withdrawn, and if the license is granted for the individual, and then C, the individual's application for a license is refused, or the principal's license is refused, or the application by the principal to vary the license is refused, D, that the individual ceases to act for or on behalf of the principal in relation to the RA, then in these circumstances, the deemed status will end And again, whatever happens first will also mean the end of the status. And then bracket 2, an individual deemed to be licensed under section 14.3 of the schedule. 14.3 means to add expanded type 9 RA in the license. Now, when will this end? When the individual's or the principal's application is withdrawn, or when the individual's license is varied, or when the varying of the license by adding expanded type 9 RA is refused, or that the principal's license is refused, or the principal's application to vary the license is refused, then whatever happens first, again, that would mean the end of the deemed status. Bracket D. If the person or individual ceases to act for or on behalf of the principal, again, the status will end. Okay, no questions. 19. Consequences of deemed status. Representatives. This section applies to an individual who is deemed to be licensed under Section 14.2 of the Schedule. During the period the individual is deemed to be licensed, now for the purposes of Section 1382, 1384, what does it mean? 1382 and 4 are existing sections. I think I have already talked about these, and this has to do with the paying of the annual fee and the submission of the annual report. Number 20, please. When deemed status ends, this is about responsible officers. In the following events, whichever happens first, the status will end. The RR application is withdrawn, or the application is refused, or the application to vary an individual's license is refused, or the application by a responsible officer is withdrawn, or the responsible officer's application has been granted, or the application being refused for the responsible officer, or the individual does not act on or on behalf of the principal, or the principal's application is withdrawn, or the principal's application is refused, or the varying of RA in the principal's license is refused. Okay. No questions from members. We can go to 21, issue of no deeming notices by commission. Thank you, Chairman. 21. It talks about issue of no deeming notices by commission. If the commission is not satisfied that a corporate application is done under 1161 or 1271, or that the commission is not satisfied that the conditions in sections of this schedule have been met, then the commission can issue no deeming notices. 1161 or 1271 are existing sections in the law. 116 is about that corporations would have to be licensed in order to undertake RA, and 1271, it talks about the types of RA in the license by varying the license. And then section 13 of the schedule, I can give you an example that the application is not made within the application period. And then bracket 2, if the commission is not satisfied that the application is made in accordance with section 1201 or 1271, or that it is not satisfied that the conditions in section 14 of the schedule have been met, again, the no deeming notice can be issued by the SFC. 1201 is an existing section in the law. It is about application to be a licensed representative. And then 1271 is about varying the RA in a license. Section 14 of the schedule is about certain conditions, and one of the examples is that the relevant application is not made within the application period. Bracket 3, it is very similar. It is actually basically the same as the previous two subsections, but this is about certain responsible officer. If it is not made according to certain sections or does not meet the relevant conditions, then again the SFC can issue no deeming notices. Okay, if there are no questions, let us go to Division 3. Division 3 is about authorized financial institutions and individuals. The previous sections are about LRs. Here, we are talking about authorized financial institutions, or let's say banks. 22. It says that if an authorized financial institution is not registered to carry out the existing Type 9 RA, then this section will apply to them. Bracket 2. Any authorized financial institution that applies in accordance with Section 1191 to carry on expanded Type 9 RA is deemed to be registered, but it has to comply with conditions in Subsection 4. Let me explain Section 1191. It is an existing section in the law. It stipulates that the SFC can register authorized financial institutions and issue registration certificates so that it can undertake RAs. Bracket 3. If an authorized financial institution applies to vary the RA specified in a certificate of registration, and if it complies with subsection 4, then it will be regarded as having been registered to undertake RA. Section 127 bracket 1 is an existing section in the law. It stipulates that the SFC can vary the certificate of registration of an authorized financial institution, and that is the RAs in that certificate. Bracket 4, it lists the relevant conditions. A, the application is made within the application period. And at an earlier part of the meeting, we explained that the application period is 3 months counting from the commencement of the RA. That's the application period. B, not less than two individuals. And with regard to the duties of an executive officer, application is made and they have not been issued no deeming notices. Here, we talk about 7.1D of the Banking Ordinance. It stipulates that every authorized financial institution must appoint not less than two executive officers who will directly supervise the RAs of that institution. C, one of the conditions is that subsection 5 is complied with, and D, that the applicant has not been issued a no deeming notice before the deeming date.
Subsection 5, the applicant must submit, together with the application, a confirmation form . The confirmation form needs to confirm A, the applicant has been carrying on in Hong Kong a qualifying activity for the qualification period. The schedule has defined qualification activity at least 2 years before the qualifying before the regulated activity. In B, not less than two individuals have applied to obtain consent under Section 71C, bracket 1, bracket A of the Banking Ordinance and they have to satisfy Section 23(3)(a). The Banking Ordinance 71(c)(1)(a) stipulates that without the bank, without the monetary authority permission, they cannot be officers of the institute. C says the applicant is in compliance or has arrangements in place to ensure compliance with any provisions of this ordinance. D, the applicant is in compliance with the 7th schedule of the banking ordinance. Paragraph 6 of the 7th schedule relates to having sufficient financial resources. E, if the applicant is a locally incorporated financial institution, they also have to comply under Part 16A, Banking Ordinance, some financial capital requirements, bracket 6. The deeming under subsections 2 and 3 will take effect on the date immediately after the end of the transitional period and ends in accordance with Section 24 of the schedule. 23, deeming of executive officers. An individual who applies for consent under Section 71(c)(1) of the Banking Ordinance is deemed to have consent to be an executive officer. The conditions in subsection 3 are the application for consent is made within the application period. The authorized financial institution has already made an application and they need to comply with 22(4). That is an application made during the application period and so on. They also need to comply with subsection 4, and the applicant has not been issued a no-deeming notice. 4, the applicant must submit a confirmation form confirming that the applicant has been carrying on in Hong Kong a qualifying activity for the qualification period. In the schedule definition, this qualification period is 2 years before the commencement of this regulated activity. Subsection 5, the deeming under subsection 2 takes effect on the date immediately after the end of the transitional period and ends in accordance with section 26 of the schedule. 24, when deemed status ends, subsection 1 and 2 deal with where they have made a variation in the application. If the application is withdrawn or the certificate of registration is granted, or if it has been refused, then the earliest, whichever happens first, will be deemed as ended. Authorized financial institutions, consequences of deemed status. It applies to 22, authorized financial institutions registered under section 22, bracket 2. Subsection 3 says, during the period the authorized financial institution is so deemed, The deeming date is to be regarded for the purposes of section 138 bracket 2. This is in relation to annual fees, and we had explained that many times before. Subsection 4. During the period of the authorized financial institution is deemed to be registered under subsection 22 bracket 2. It is also deemed to be the subject to the condition that it must not carry on securities or futures contracts management. They can only handle OTC management. When deemed status ends for executive officers, the status ends when the application is withdrawn or consent is given. In 71(c)(1), the monetary authority gives consent. C, the application is refused, or the authorized financial institution application is withdrawn, or a refusal is to grant the authorized financial institution, or there is a refusal to vary a regulated activity. No questions? 27. The issue of no deeming notices by commission and monetary authority. The SFC may, after consultation, issue a notice to an application may issue a notice to the applicant that the applicant is not to be deemed to be registered under that section. If the commission is not satisfied that the application is made in accordance, the condition in section 22 bracket 4 has been met, the applicant has confirmed the matters such as they qualify in the qualifying period, D, they have not been issued, no deeming notices have been issued. So the commission may, after consulting with the monetary authority, issue a notice of no deeming notice. Section 2, the monetary authority may issue a notice to an applicant that the applicant is not to be deemed they can issue this no deeming notice. Any questions? Let's continue. Division 4. And we can stop there. Division 4 relates to corporations and individuals licensed for existing Type 9 RA. 28. Corporations deemed conditioned. If immediately before the commencement date, they have been carrying out Type 9 RA activity, this is applicable unless the corporation complies with subsections 3 and 4, then they cannot they must not carry new Type 9 activity. After the end of the transitional period, they cannot conduct Type 9A activity. So they have to comply with subsections 3 and 4. The corporation must, within the application period for the expanded Type 9 RA, they need to notify the commission in writing the new Type 9 activity. They will provide a full description of the nature of the business, the types of services provided, and the human and technical resources, and so on. They have to show that they are capable of carrying on these activities, and they also need to provide a business history, a business plan, together with the related, they also have to submit a confirmation form. They have to confirm that at least one of its responsible offices has been carrying on in Hong Kong the qualifying activity for the qualification period. And in our interpretation, we have defined qualification activity. That is, at least 2 years out of 6 years before the commencement of this new regulated activity. They also need to confirm that the corporation is in compliance with the provisions of the ordinance. No questions? 29. The responsible officer's deemed condition. This section applies to an individual who is approved as a responsible officer of a corporation licensed to carry on existing Type 9 RA. Unless the individual complies with subsections 3 and 4, the licensed representative license of the individual is deemed on and from the date immediately after the end of the transitional period. In subsection 3, the individual must, within the application period for the expanded Type 9 RA activity, notify the commission. And 4, the individual must submit a confirmation form confirming that the individual has been carrying on in Hong Kong or also a qualifying activity for the qualification period. In the schedule, the qualifying period is defined as 2 years, at least 2 years out of the 6 years before the commencement date of the regulated activity. Any questions? If not, we'll stop here. Next meeting, 20th of December, 8:30 in the morning. Okay, thank you. We adjourn the meeting. Thank you.